What is up, guys? I do hope you're well, and welcome to another episode of Entitled Parents. If you are new here, please consider hitting that like, that subscribe button, and maybe the notification bell. And let's get straight into it. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, I deserve a luxury rental car. While my car is in your shop, or your services, I will drop. Creative title, I like it. A couple of years ago, I started working in the front office of a collision repair centre. Let's call it Fix It Queen. The shop specialised in fixing damaged cars from auto accidents, but sometimes that would take on mechanical repair work as well. We had, at the time, two mechanics with about 50 years of combined experience and certifications, four or five painters, three detail guys to wash and vacuum cars, and about eight repair technicians. My job was to estimate the damage, submit our estimated cost to the customer or insurance company, whoever was paying, and secure payment for the estimate. This took place in January or February, after a recent snowfall. The customer, I'll call her Emma, came in with two small children, probably no older than 6 or 7 years old. Her accident hadn't injured the children, but her Audi SUV had slid on a patch of ice and struck a guardrail, damaging the back quarter panel and both doors. As part of the customer service process, I introduced myself and sat down to discuss a few things with her. I basically knew she was going to be trouble with her first remark was, "Oh, you're the guy I'm supposed to talk to." I thought I'd have someone different. I let the implications of that statement go, laughed it off, and explained the repair process. I asked if she was having her car repaired at our shop, and she said she had questions. Did we use Audi parts? Yes, we had a deal with a local Audi dealership and used their parts to store for Audi and several other high-end vehicles. How long would the repairs take? Less than 2 weeks. Everything needed to be replaced, then repainted to match. We would check all the doors and sensors and even test drive our car before calling her to state it was fixed. Were the repairs guaranteed? Yes, for as long as she owned the car, we would guarantee any paint and parts put on her car. We would also provide invoices for the Audi parts store. Did we have any rental cars available? No, the rental was handled by our insurance company. Now, Fix It Queen had a partnership with her insurance company, so the insurance had already sent her a rental car company that could come pick her up. I presented Emma with a contract slash power of attorney that reiterated what I had said verbally, advised that she pick up any belongings, and in an 11-point font stated that any work done would have to be paid for before a vehicle could leave the shop. We didn't use small print for our contracts because corporate said so. I told Emma that she would owe $500 deductible, according to her insurance company, when she came to pick it up. Emma signed and I made a copy of her driver's license. Emma went outside with a rental car company agent. Let's call her Mystique. I filled her paperwork and returned to the lobby area to find Mystique and Emma standing there, both frustrated. Emma was mad that the rental car being given to her was a Chevrolet Impala and not an Audi. Mystique said, "Do you all have an Audi or similar vehicle you could rent out to her?" And I said, "No, we don't do rentals. We fix damaged cars. We don't rent them out." Emma sucked her teeth. "That's very rude of you to say. My insurance company said they would have another car like mine here for pickup, and I want another car like mine. I have two small children, and I need to keep them safe." I explained again to Emma that we could not do this, and she huffed and sat down to call her insurance company. Mystique sat down to play on her phone. I guess I should explain that Fix It Queen had a lobby area, and they were sitting on the sofas in the lobby, with Emma's two children playing around them. Emma talked very loudly to her insurance agent, and to escape the noise, I went to do my job. I went to Emma's Audi SUV, drove it into the shop, and assigned it to a technician. When I returned to my office, Emma was still on the phone yelling about a substandard rental car. My boss came to the door of my office and asked what was going on, so I explained and told him that I was taking care of it. I continued to ignore Emma's ranting on the phone and threats to drop her insurance company, so I could call the Audi dealership to order parts. My contact there verified parts prices and guaranteed delivery by end of the workday. I sent the order to her insurance company to have payment transferred to us, and went to tell Emma the good news. A few more minutes, Emma got off the phone. She had been in the lobby for a little over an hour. I asked how things had gone with her insurance. Emma basically stated that she was going to take her car and leave, and would drop her insurance, as no one was helpful. I asked Emma to hold on and went into the shop to find her car. Auto repair technicians usually work quickly, because the more cars they work on, the more they can get paid. I found Emma's Audi SUV with both doors removed, the rear bumper loosened, and the tech was working to remove the right tail lamp. All of these steps were necessary to replace her damaged doors and quarter panel. I returned inside and told Emma what had happened. She shrieked at me, shrieked and grabbed her hair, because we already started working on a car. She accused us of working on a car without permission, threatened to sue us, and called me an idiot. I went to the office, made a quick copy of her signed contract and brought it to Emma. I told her that she had given us legally binding permission to work on her car, and that we had begun work per that agreement. I also told her that in accord with our work authorization, if she chose to remove her car, she'd first have to pay the fees for the work already done. We would stop work until we could verify how we would receive payment. I also told her that Mystique would be able to advise the rental car company fees on upgrading her rental. Over the next 3 days, Emma called several times, her insurance called several times, and other collision repair shops called several times. Everyone wanted to know how the repairs were going, what was going on, etc. My answers were always the same. Emma owed a $200 bill for the labour involved in starting the repairs and cancelling the parts order. And after the first 24 hours, we were charged $25 per day in storage. We would not do any further work until we were paid for what had been done. By the end of the week, Emma came in personally, talked to my boss, and agreed to repairs, and she was going to pay out of pocket for an Audi rental for her children. Her car was fixed by the end of the following week, but I think her insurance ended up dropping her because we charged them for storage fees in accordance with our contract. What a pain in the ass person, man. I mean, just because you ain't getting the rental car that you want, you think you can just start walking over people and demanding things. It's just like typical entitled parents. I mean, just got to feel sorry for the kids, because obviously the parent is just a right nightmare. EP thought I was going to pay her bills to babysit her kid. I originally posted this on r/entitledbitch, and a commenter suggested I share it here, so I copied and pasted it for you guys, with the exception of changing EB to EP for clarity. Enjoy. This happened about 4 years ago. This EP is my older sister. Ever since her daughter was born, she's always treated everyone in the family like mandatory free babysitters, and while it's always been annoying in the past, this incident took the freaking cake. So when this happened, I wanted to save up money to move to Europe. EP and my brother were living in the same house at the time, and we thought it would be a good idea for me to stay with the family and help with rent. All the while, I could save up money to move abroad. At this time, I just started dating my now fiancé. But back then, we weren't serious. All the more reason I'm grateful I didn't go. Anyway, sometime during our conversations, I'd mentioned that I wouldn't mind watching my niece from time to time while living there. I started looking for a job in the area I'd be moving to, and casually mentioned to my sister that I'd be filling out an open availability on the applications. This was when her real intentions came out. She got into a huge argument with me about how I couldn't work nights or weekends because she needed me to babysit her kid. My experience is in customer service and retail, so basically, that's not an option for me. I asked her if she intended on paying me to babysit, and this is how the conversation went. No, because you still need to help me with the bills. Dumbfounded silence as I processed what I just heard. Wait, so you want me to pay to move out there? Find a customer service job that will hire me only daytime availability so I can watch your kid for free? And fork over what little money I make to help with your bills? Yeah, so? Are you out of your effing mind? She's your niece, you bitch. She's your daughter, why don't you try spending more time with her instead of pulling her off to other people every night so you can go F dudes? The rest of the conversation is fuzzy, but needless to say, I'm glad I stayed where I am, where I'm now engaged, and not living with a crazy EB who seems to think God put me on this earth to serve her babysitting needs. Oh my word. Ian demands I put my pit bull down. So this is the second time I've run into someone so pissed about dog breeds. This happened Saturday. Check my profile for some other stories about my dog. I'll link a photo at the end. Backstory, for y'all who don't know, I own a white and bull pitbull black Jack Russell mix. She looks like a small pit. We rescued her from an abusive situation which involves dog fighting, physical abuse, breeding, etc. Here we go. I was walking through a forest trail near my house. I live in Michigan, so there are a lot of state parks, when a kid comes sprinting around the corner. This is PK. Poor kid. EM is still around the corner, so I can't see her yet. Doggy! Doggy! Can I pet him, mister? Sure, lad. She loves kids. My dog does that thing where she flops on her side and then rolls over, so that she looks like a dead spider with her legs in the air. She has that big pit bull smile, as some people put it, on her face, and the kid starts giving her a belly rub. She loved it. Then EM starts around the corner. At first, she doesn't look concerned. She sees her smiling kid playing with a dog. As she gets closer, she sees the breed and yanks her 10-year-old away with the force of someone dragging her kid out of a burning car. "No, Mum, that man has a nice dog and I want to play." "How dare you put my kid in a dangerous situation?" "It's not dangerous, Mum, it's a nice doggy." She's not going to bite, she loves kids. At this point, my dog was scared because EM's yelling, so her ears and tail went straight down and she started crying a bit. Apparently saying my dog was fine with kids was the wrong thing. EM, somehow louder. "She loves kids." "Yeah, I bet that demon loves to eat kids. You should put that devil down." "I'm not gonna do that." She started walking towards me, so I scooped my dog up and booked it back home. Here's a picture of the dog. What a good doggo. I love dogs. I never understand people that like hate certain breeds of dogs. I know pit bulls get like a bad rep with like the dog fighting and stuff, but it's like, come on, man. Come on. It's not the dog's fault, is it? It's the people that brought them up to fight and stuff like that. Entitled kid doesn't know how to shut up on a plane flight. So I don't know exactly if this post falls into entitled parents, but I think it'd be a good place to post it. And yes, I'm on a computer and English is my first language, so feel free to criticize my grammar in the comments. This is also my first post to this thread. I remembered this experience after seeing some posts in this thread. This happened last summer when I was traveling overseas, and my entire family was excited for the trip. I have a tendency not to sleep on most flights and play games. We had to wake up super early to catch the first flight, 5 hours, and had an hour to make it to the next flight after we landed, 12 hours. The first flight was pretty smooth, got to play games on my phone and 3DS without anyone bothering me. But the second flight was one of the worst flights I've ever took. It all started pretty smooth, took out my games again and I started playing. Behind me sat the EK with her mum and dad next to her. The EK looked semi-mature, about 8 or 9 years old, but boy was I wrong. At first I didn't notice that EK was kicking my seat because I was so engrossed in the game, but the only reason I noticed the EK is because she began kicking the seat harder. I was quite socially awkward back then, so I didn't want to handle the situation myself. Because of this, I asked to swap seats with my sister, because I'm quite short-tempered, and they knew that something was about to happen. Fortunately, my mum, who was also in the same row as us, helped me calm down after I swapped seats, and my sister was able to be in that seat and not have as much trouble as I did, because I had to wake up early in the morning and just had a 5-hour flight with no sleep. I resided to get some well-deserved rest, and the airplane had dimmed the lights. But then it happened. The EK started singing out of nowhere. She began to sing her limited playlist of about 3 songs she knew for almost the entire flight. Maybe it wouldn't have bothered me as much if she was good at singing, or loud enough that anyone in the 5 rows of the plane could clearly hear her. She was also coughing every couple of seconds. At this point I was visually irritated, and my mum noticed that I was. So she politely asked the parents to quiet down their child. They did manage to make her stop, but only for a couple of minutes. Then she was back at it again. They didn't even try to fix the situation, but let her sing to her heart's content. This happened a few times until we eventually called a flight attendant to stop the situation. The flight attendant did manage to stop the EK for a bit longer than the parents did, but it was no use. Unfortunately, there is no happy ending to this story. I only ended up getting 1 hour sleep on that flight, so I was only half awake that entire day. Also, we somehow managed to have our bags get lost on the connection flight, and it took us 4 days to get them back. I ended up falling asleep at a table at a restaurant for a few minutes before getting woken up by my family. At least I got to take a nice sleep at the Airbnb we were staying at. Oh, I mean, that's like, gotta be the worst situation, having a child sing at the top of their lungs behind you when you're trying to sleep. I mean, it's partially your fault for playing the games on the flight anyway and not getting some sleep beforehand. But yeah, I feel for you, dude. I feel for you. Kid pulled off my sister's headscarf. Background, I'm a 16-year-old boy, and this happened a few weeks ago. My sister, who is my twin, had experienced this by some a-hole, won't put his name. I live in San Diego, California. EK entitled kid, his name starts with S. EM, racist mum. ED, racist dad. M, my mum. D, my dad. TS, my twin sister. I'm in a predominantly white high school, but there's a few Asians and Middle Easterns and blacks. I don't look Muslim at all, same with my sister. We're pretty white, but my parents are Indian looking, same goes to my family. There was this kid EK, he was the bully of the school. So on Tuesday at school, when me and my sister and our friends were going to class, I heard a scream, and my sister was on the ground with her hijab pulled back, showing a little hair. I took off my jacket and gave it to her. I saw EK laughing, so I went over to him and punched him in the face pretty hard. I box and wrestle, so I have a pretty built body. EJ was on the ground with a bloody nose. I quickly went over to my sister and made sure she was okay. My friends were keeping her away from the chaos, but she saw what was happening. She yelled at me to turn around. So I did, and was met with a punch to my jaw which hurt pretty badly. But when I regained my strength, I threw EK on the ground. Then the principal took us to his office and called our parents. Both my parents arrived quickly, while Scott's parents took about an hour. We all sat down. My sister was in the room with us. She isn't much of a talker, but once you get to know her, she never shuts up. Anyway, our principal explained what happened. Both of our parents were peed. EK started to talk about what happened, completely lying about what happened. Then I started to get mad and stood up and told them the real story. This is the conversation that occurred. Are you sure that's what happened? Because EK doesn't lie. Mum, that's exactly what happened. Your son pulled down my sister's headscarf and called her a terrorist. Maybe she shouldn't have worn that because she is a terrorist for wearing that. This is where me and my dad got peed. What did you just say? How do you know we're terrorists? Maybe you're the terrorist because you killed many Muslims and continue to slaughter them left and right, even innocent ones. You started the war because, as I recall, your president invaded Iraq without any motives. You guys just saw an opportunity and did what you did. This has been happening for thousands of years. You kill people in any country and blame it on them. You captured a bunch of Africans and used them as slaves because they aren't white. So tell me who the terrorist is. Guys, I don't remember everything my dad said. These are just bits I remember he said. Some of it is forgotten by me, so I apologize what is written, because again, I don't remember everything my dad said. Yeah, and what gives you the right to call my sister and my family a terrorist when we did nothing to you? Whoa, now I don't want any trouble. I'm just stating facts. I saw my sister with tears in her eyes, and I went to my sister and gave her a hug. I'm pretty protective of my sister. Look what you did to her. You're making her cry, and she didn't do anything to EK. In fact, she helped him on his homework so he could pass the maths exam. She's been nice to him all the time. You know what? I'm taking you kids out of this school. Clearly you people are primitive. My mum didn't speak a word because my dad took the words out of her mouth. Before we came out of the school, me and my sister got our stuff and said goodbye to our friends and teachers. I have my friend's phone number so I can hang out with them all the time. We went to the car and never came back. Edit, I want to address that my dad didn't mean to say what he said. When we got to the car, he was disappointed in himself for acting crazy. That's all, folks. Don't be racist, that's all. I'm sorry if some of this offended you guys. I don't want a huge comment war with racism and everything. My dad was just angry at the guy and hates people like this, who think they are better than the rest, and don't want to take any blame in anything like this. Yeah, I can see your dad probably being pissed off, especially like seeing his daughter have her hijab taken down and things, and if she did get called a terrorist, then let rip, man. You know, people say a lot of things in the heat of the moment, you know, so screw it. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for being here today. It really does mean the world to me that you guys are still watching my video and showing your support. So thank you so much. Take care now. Goodbye.